The next item of business is consideration of business motion 13317 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to the business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion.
It moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak to the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 13317 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions, and at question number one, I call Miles Briggs.
An officer to ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reported figures showing the average rent increase at a higher rate in Scotland than any other region or nation in the UK between September 2022 and March 2024.
Minister Paul McLennan.
These Scotland statistics are based predominantly on newly advertised rents and do not take into account in-tenancy rent increases, which were initially frozen and then largely kept at 3% while an emergency legislation was in place. They do not represent the whole private rented sector in Scotland, so are not suitable for like-for-like comparisons with other parts of the UK. Our housing bill includes a package of reforms to improve affordability and strengthen tenants' rights. We will continue to work with stakeholders across the sector as we develop a system of rent control that works for Scotland.
Miles Briggs.
I thank the Minister for that answer, and I think what is more important than the words, which similar to what he put out in his press release at the weekend, is actually looking at what's happening on the ground. And Scottish Conservatives warned ministers that the only outcome of the SNP Green Government's approach to rent controls would be higher rents and the loss of supply, both of which are now becoming apparent. So does the Minister now accept that rent controls have been a disaster for tenants by decimating the housing market and are pushing up rents in Scotland?
Minister.
I think there's a couple of things to put into context here. I think, as stated by the ONS, Scotland's rent data and statistics are mainly for advertising rents, which I think is really important. And the ONS itself advises users to bear this in mind when interpreting estimates for Scotland and comparing with other UK countries. They also go on to say, in terms of that, that any that existing tenants benefit from rent controls and changes to the rent adjudication system will lead to overestimation in stock prices and indices for Scotland since late 2022. So that's a really important context to add in terms of that. I think the other important thing is the number of the latest figures that we have in terms of the number of tenants. The Landlord Register shows an increase of 2.1% between August 22 and April 2024. And as I said, we'll continue through the Housing Bill and engaging with yourself, Mr Briggs, in terms of that, to engage with stakeholders in that regard.
Miles Briggs.
Last week, the government did declare a housing emergency, and many in the sector welcomed that and have been expressing concern for some time now that the SNP housing bill will only make matters worse. The current rent-setting provision in the bill will only prevent the investment, which the Minister himself has said he's really keen to secure in Scotland. So can I ask the Minister if the Scottish Government will now honestly look towards a more flexible rent regulation approach than one which is currently outlined in the housing bill?
Minister.
Yeah, as he knows, I've met with stakeholders, including investors, on a number of occasions to discuss that, and there is always a balance, as I said, between protecting those in the most vulnerable areas in terms of rent controls and also trying to encourage investment into that. As I said, we continue to meet stakeholders as part of the Housing Bill process.
Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Would the Minister agree that the UK Government is backtracking on even the most basic reforms to the private renting sector? Proves that without a doubt Scotland's the best place to rent in the UK, with stronger tenants' rights and a commitment through the upcoming Housing Bill to fairer, more affordable housing for all.
Minister.
Yeah, with robust tenants' rights and unwavering commitment to fairer, more affordable housing for all through the forthcoming Housing Bill, Scotland is set in high standard. In those challenging times, it's absolutely essential that we concentrate our efforts on supporting the most vulnerable in society, and that's the balance I talked about earlier on. Our shared objective is to provide safe, affordable and high-quality homes for all. A well-regulated private rented sector benefits everyone involved, tenants, landlords and investors alike. This is not a novel concept. Our European neighbours already have proven that a strong regulatory framework is compatible with a sizeable private rented sector. We will strive to emulate and surpass these successful models to ensure that the best possible outcomes for all stakeholders in the housing sector.
Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just to let members to my register of interest, which shows that I ceased being a private landlord last summer. The huge rent increases are a symptom of the housing emergency, which Parliament and Government acknowledged last week. Can I ask the Minister when the Government expect to formally respond to that declaration and bring forward actions to lift the country out of the housing emergency that we are experiencing?
Minister.
Yeah, again, I'll come back to the context the ONS set on these particular figures. And I think, as Mr Briggs knows and Mr Griffin knows, I was keen to discuss with them or obviously around about the housing bill and also in the housing emergency. I've already engaged very recently, just at the weekend there, talking about with stakeholders. So again, we're discussing the best way to take that forward. But again, happy to discuss that with them, as I've indicated previously.
Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Here we are again. The ONS repeatedly warned that these statistics cannot be compared like for like, and repeatedly those who lobby for landlord profits and against tenant interests show that they don't care about that reality. But given that between tenancy rent increases are too high, does the Minister agree it would be utterly perverse to use that as a justification to remove protection from those between tenancy increases from the rent control proposals in the housing bill?
Minister.
Yeah, I would agree with Mr Harvey in terms of the ONS statistics, and I think that's really important to set that context, as has been mentioned here before. And in terms of the wider housing bill discussions, we are continuing to engage with stakeholders about achieving the balance that I mentioned previously.
Brief supplementary, Daniel Johnson.
I'm sure the Minister would agree with me that the key to solving the housing emergency is boosting investment and boosting supply. Given that the sector is clear that it's the lack of clarity in the housing bill that's a concern, is the government considering a national formula for rent regulation to provide the consistency and clarity that the sector is asking for?
Minister.
Yes, Mr Johnson knows I've met with investors on a number of occasions, also met obviously with the likes of Living Rent and so on as well to discuss their concerns. I think obviously where we're looking, the housing bill provisions have been published, and again what we're looking to do is engage with stakeholders on the point that he's mentioned in that particular point. So we'll listen to investors, we'll continue to listen to the likes of Living Rent as well, and try and achieve that balance that I've mentioned about previously.
Thank you. Question number two, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government for what reason it has reportedly withdrawn all funding for the National Parent Forum of Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
The Scottish Government recognises and celebrates the need for strong parental engagement in children's education. As such, we have concluded that there is a need to establish a broader, more representative model to support engagement from parents and carers. I am particularly conscious of the need to hear from a wider range of perspectives and experiences, including traditionally underrepresented groups such as parents and carers from minority ethnic backgrounds and those who have children with additional support needs. Given their reach across Scotland, we have asked Connect to work with us to establish a national parent panel. Members will play a critical role in informing policy and providing advice and challenge to government as we drive improvement in our education system. And I would like to take the opportunity to thank MPFS and all of the volunteers who have helped to support their vital work over the years. I look forward to meeting with them later this week to discuss the ways in which they might be able to support this new approach moving forward.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and of course you'll be aware that Cheryl Burnett, the chair of the forum, has said, and I quote, she was shocked that a government headed by John Swinney, who was among the MSPs that worked to found the National Parent Forum of Scotland in the wake of the 2006 Parental Involvement Act, would defund our vital work without any direct consultation. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, can she explain how parents were engaged in the decision-making process to defund the forum, and can she confirm how much money this decision will save?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question, for her interest in this issue, and I very much recognise the need for stronger parental engagement. And the approach that I have set out through the new National Parent Panel, I think, will give us a better opportunity to hear from a wider range of voices across the system. Now, in relation to the point on consultation, my officials have been directly engaged with MPFS throughout this process. I've had sight of the letter that Cheryl Burnett has shared with the First Minister, and obviously I will be meeting with Cheryl this week, and I again want to put on the record my thanks to her for all of the work she's contributed to a range of different priorities for the government over the years, but most recently her contributions on behaviour have been really worthwhile, and I very much hope that all of the volunteers, including Cheryl, who were involved in MPFS, will contribute to this national parent panel. It is worthwhile saying there was a level of duplication, I think, in the way in which we engage with parents and carers nationally. I think this will give us a better opportunity to hear from those wider range of options in relation to views in the system. The member asked a specific point in relation to funding, and I want to put on the record the current funding agreement with MPFS, which for the previous, or this financial year rather, Presiding Officer, was £53,317 in 2023-24, last financial year. That covered running costs, but it includes expenses for volunteer representatives. It does not include any staffing costs. And as of the 21st of this month, MPFS had an underspend of £13,247. So I hope that gives the member an understanding of the financials that are involved in this decision, but my very clear steer that this funding will now be used to support a new approach to a national parent panel, in which I very much hope that members of MPFS will be engaged.
We have much interest, so let's keep our questions and responses concise. Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. And while she talks about engagement from her officials, the National Parent Forum have said that this was news to them. The Cabinet Secretary will also be aware that the National Parent Forum is a statutory and notifiable body. So can the Cabinet Secretary confirm how the government intends to take the power from the forum and put it into a new body? And specifically, can she say whether Parliament will have a say on this change?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm not necessarily clear from the advice I've had from officials that Parliament requires to have a say on the changes in relation to the funding, but I'm more than happy to write to the member on that specific point. I do, though, think there's an opportunity post-pandemic for us to look at parental engagement in the system. And we know, anecdotally, that parental engagement post-pandemic has been challenging for a number of our schools. I was in Aberdeen, for example, earlier this year, talking to elected members there about the challenges they've had in engaging with parents post-pandemic. So it's really important we have a renewed focus on that. And of course, as we know, the OECD and the PISA results that published towards the end of last year talked about strong educational systems reflecting strong parental engagements, and that being really key in disadvantaged communities. So I see this as an opportunity to strengthen parental engagement, not weaken it, and I very much look forward to working with Cheryl and, of course, the MPFS volunteers the member has alluded to that end.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. What diligence was done on the new provider before making this decision? And can we see it, along with the total anticipated costs arising?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, my officials have been in discussion with Connect, who of course are the proposed new organisation to host the National Parent Panel, for some time about the potential for Connect to be offered funding to establish this new parent panel. As a registered charity with that professional staff and a board, it is my officials' assessment and the advice I've been given that this organisation is well placed to host a panel to establish a more robust mechanism of gathering the views of a more diverse and representative range of parents. And I go back to some of the point I was making to Ms Duncan-Glancy on that. We need to hear from a wider range of views in relation to the advice that ministers are receiving from Scotland's parents. But those detailed proposals and grant funding arrangements are currently under discussion, and Connect have indicated that the panel will cost in the region of £50,000 a year to establish, and they are working to have that new mechanism established in time for the new academic year, which I think is important. And if the member heard the figures I shared with Ms Duncan-Glancy in relation to the funding from MPFS, he will recognise the parity that is being provided in that regard.
Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary has comprehensively made clear that the Government has taken this decision in order to strengthen engagement with parents and carers. I wonder if there's anything further that the Cabinet Secretary can add, particularly in and around the role of the views of parents and carers and what that can play in this.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think it's worthwhile recounting that to date parents and carers have had a number of different opportunities to contribute to engagement in relation to education reform, including, of course, through the National Discussion, which published last year, the Independent Review of Qualifications and Assessment, and the consultation on the provisions of the Education Bill. And the Government is obviously committed to strengthening our approach to parental engagement, as I've intimated today, to ensure that we have a range of different opportunities for parents and carers to shape, to influence policy development, and to provide challenge to government too. We need to ensure, though, at this really critical juncture in relation to education reform, that we have meaningful engagement which draws on that wider range of perspectives and experiences from all parts of Scotland. So those partnerships with parents and carers are absolutely crucial to reforming our education system and ensuring that together we tackle some of the challenges we are facing at the current time, such as attendance, behaviour and mobile phone use in schools, for example. And we are confident that our new approach in establishing a national parent panel will achieve this.
Stephen Kerr.
Well, it's good to hear the Cabinet Secretary talk about broadening engagement with parents, but the obvious question is, why couldn't the National Parent Forum of Scotland be the vehicle for broadening that engagement? Why such a radical change, and particularly the abrupt nature of the change?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I don't accept it is particularly radical, and I also don't accept it's particularly abrupt, given some of the changes to funding that I intimated in a response to a previous member in today's session. I'm more than happy to share details of that with Mr Kerr. Connect, as a parental organisational charity with professional staff team and Reach Across Scotland, have been asked to establish the National Parent Panel to ensure that strengthened approach is delivered. And it is aimed, as I mentioned, at ensuring that broader range of views is captured. Detailed work is well underway between Connect and my officials to set up that mechanism, which, as I responded to, I think the member's colleague, Mr Kerr, will be operational in time for the start of the new academic year, which I think is really crucial.
Question number three, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is regarding any implications for community safety to the events that occurred in Trongate, Glasgow, following Celtic Football Club's league title win.
Minister Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government condemns the incidents of violence, vandalism and antisocial behaviour that took place in Glasgow on Saturday. Any threat to public safety and any damage caused by the disorder is just not acceptable. We fully support Police Scotland and other emergency services and thank them for their response. We also support Glasgow City Council, who were left to clear up the rubbish and damage, and I appreciate the help that was given by the Celtic football fans in the aftermath and their engagement with football clubs to prevent future incidents. Whilst the vast majority of fans are well behaved, it is clear when a minority do not, there is wide-ranging implications. Governing bodies and individual clubs must consider what measures they can take and how they can use their influence to help tackle misconduct.
John Mason.
I thank the Minister for that answer, and she's already been quite strong in her condemnation of what happened. But does she agree with me as well that it is unacceptable that a major road junction in Glasgow is completely blocked to buses and other traffic? The Tron Theatre had to cancel its performance that evening. Allegedly, four police officers were injured, and the Royal A&E was completely swamped. I myself walked in the area at 6:30 on Saturday, people urinating in the pens, closes, and residents afraid to leave their homes.
Minister.
Thank you, and I agree 100% with the member. It is absolutely unacceptable that businesses had to close, public property was damaged, people were not able to go about their business, and indeed people were injured. There is no reason why that should be a celebration. It degenerates into disorder, causes damage to property and results in loss of custom and business, as well as, of course, the cost to the public purse in terms of policing, the NHS response and the clean-up afterwards. Whilst I don't know the full cost yet for the council, I understand that last year's clean-up cost amounted to over £34,000. Police Scotland has confirmed it will continue to work to identify those responsible to bring them to justice.
John Mason.
I thank the Minister for the further answer. Looking ahead to the future, would she agree with me that clubs need to get more involved in taking responsibility for their fans, perhaps organising fan zones, and perhaps strict liability, including things like partial stadium closures, points deductions and fines, as happens in Europe, should be considered? And can she give any reassurance that the clubs will take responsibility this coming Saturday for their fans' behaviour?
Siobhan Brown.
Thank you. We will continue to work with the footballing authorities, Police Scotland and fan groups to address issues and ensure football matches are an enjoyable game experience for everyone during the game and afterwards. We've never ruled out strict liability as an option for incidents at football within stadiums. However, our preferred solution has always been that the footballing authorities themselves proactively shape and deliver a robust and meaningful solution to tackle any unacceptable conduct by what is a minority of supporters. I understand that Glasgow City Council has had discussions with clubs to discuss organised celebrations, and I fully encourage such dialogue between football clubs and local authorities about conducting safe events for their fans, which minimise the impact on the community.
And Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was struck by the contrast with the trophy parade and celebrations with Arsenal winning the Premiership in England, working in conjunction with Islington Council in London. So there is a stark contrast with what's happened in Glasgow. The Celtic and Rangers both contribute around £250 million to the Scottish economy every year. Some of the biggest sporting brands in the world. Can the government convene a meeting of the key stakeholders to try and build this capability and really showcase it for Glasgow and build this as an annual celebration that we can be proud of instead of ashamed of?
Minister.
Firstly, I've been told it was Man City, that one down south. And yes, I can confirm that we will endeavour to work with all authorities to ensure that they are showcased.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.